This is the second lesson of an intense course to help you learn Affinity Photo fast. In this video, we look at saving and exporting images and using adjustment layers to edit your photos. As with the first lesson, I'm only covering the essentials of image editing with Affinity Photo. Please don't skip ahead because you'll probably miss something important. If you haven't watched the first lesson, I'll include a link to it in the YouTube information for this video. I'd also recommend you watch that before continuing with this lesson. Something that confuses a lot of new Affinity Photo users is how to save your images. You can save the photos you're working on in the File menu by selecting either the Save or Save As options. These open the Save dialog where you can navigate to the folder that you want to save your work to. It also allows you to enter the name of the document that you want to save. If I move to the end of the file name, you'll see that it has an extension of AF Photo. This is a special kind of file format used by Affinity Photo, and as far as I know, only Affinity products can read it. You'll also notice that there isn't an option to save the image in any other format. But before we look at how to produce JPEG or TIFF images, there are some special benefits you need to know about using the Affinity Photo format. When you save images in this format, you can save all the layers, masks, channels, and even editing history for your image. This makes it a non-destructive format, so you'll preserve all your editing work for the future. If you remember the first lesson of this course, we said it's best to avoid destructive editing, and that applies to saving your work as well. If instead we save this image as a JPEG file, we would lose all the layers and masks you can see in the Layers Studio panel. You might also remember that we looked at the History panel, which displayed the editing history of our image. By default, the editing history isn't saved by Affinity Photo, but you can turn this feature on. In the File menu, you'll see an option, Save History with Document. When you select this, Affinity Photo shows a warning that anyone opening the file will see your editing history. If you're doing editing work for a client, you might not want them to see this, which is why there's a warning. But as we're doing the editing work for ourselves, it's very useful, so we'll click yes to accept it. Then when we save the image, the editing history is saved in the Affinity Photo file. Now, as useful as the Affinity Photo format is, it doesn't help you share your photos on the internet. For that, we need to save images in formats like JPEG, TIFF, and PNG. The way we do this is by selecting the Export option in the File menu. You'll then see an Export dialog where you can choose the image format you want to export. I'll click the JPEG option as an example of how to use the dialog. At the top of the dialog, you can see the size of the image to be exported. This defaults to the same size as the image you're editing. Because this example is a large image, I'll reduce it to 1200 pixels on the long edge. Now notice this lock icon between the two fields. If I click the icon, it toggles the lock open and closed. When the lock's closed, it locks the aspect ratio of the image, which we covered in the first lesson. Now, if I change the size of one side of the image, Affinity Photo automatically changes the other to keep the same aspect ratio. If you don't lock the aspect ratio, you can change the height and width of the image independently, which stretches it. The other setting we can change in the JPEG dialog is the quality. The lower the quality, the smaller the image file in terms of space it occupies on the disk. There are some useful presets for this in the drop-down preset list, but you can also adjust the quality slider directly. If you want to access more advanced settings, click the More button to open a second dialog. After selecting your settings, click the Export button to open the Save dialog. Now you can enter the name of the file to export the image to. Notice that there isn't an option to change the image format because we've already chosen to export a JPEG file. To use a different format, you need to select it in the Export dialog as a first step. I'll then click Save to export the image as a JPEG. Now let's talk about layers, because the image you see on screen has already been edited. When I click the icon to the left of the group, you can see it expand to show several different layers. The group is like a special folder holding a collection of layers together. It can be helpful in organizing your layers when making a lot of adjustments. Because I've edited this image using multiple layers, I can turn the individual layers off to hide them. The background layer in this image is a pixel layer, which you can see in the bracket after its name. If I right-click on that layer with my mouse, we see a pop-up menu where I can click the duplicate option. This produces a copy of the background layer, which was my starting image. I'll just turn on the other layers again so you can see the finished image. What I want to emphasize is that the order of these layers is very important. Some layers, like pixel layers, can hide other layers. Watch what happens when I drag the duplicate background layer we created to the top of the layers panel. It hides all the other layers below it so that you see that layer and not the effect of the other layers. If I hide that layer, you can then see all the other layers below it again. It's important to understand this because you often get unexpected and confusing results if you don't. I'm now going to add an adjustment layer which I can use to edit this image. There's a useful icon at the bottom of the Layer Studio panel which displays the list of available adjustment layers. I'm going to pick the Levels layer at the top of this as it's one of the most useful. You can now see the new layer added above the layer I had selected. As I'm sure you saw in the list, there are lots of different adjustment layers. Whilst they all have uses, you don't need to understand them all, at least not initially. But I'd recommend you learn how to use Levels, Vibrance, and the black and white adjustment layers. The Curves layer is also very important, but you can do many of the same things with the Levels layer. Unlike the pixel layers, adjustment layers don't prevent you from seeing the layer below them in the Layers panel. Instead, they apply an effect to the lower layers. You may remember we talked about the histogram in the first lesson, and that it represents how light or dark pixels are in the image. If we look at the Levels dialog, we can see the histogram representing the lower layers in this image. Notice that this histogram doesn't extend all the way to the left of the range and that there's a gap. This tells us that the darkest pixels in this image aren't black. As this image was shot in the evening and has a lot of deep shadows, you would expect that at least some of the pixels were black. Let's fix this using the Levels adjustment layer. When I click and drag on the black level, moving it to the right, you can see a marker move across the histogram. What I want to do is move the marker so it just touches the left edge of the histogram. When I do this, you can see the image getting darker. What the black level does is make the pixels in the image darker until the darkest pixel then turns black. If I move the marker further to the right, it turns all the pixels in this area of the histogram black and we produce shadow clipping. When I turn the layer off and on, you can see the improvement to the image by correcting the black point. Now I can do the same with the white level. I'll move this to the left until it meets the edge of the white histogram. If you're wondering what the different coloured histograms are, they relate to the colour channels in this image. This is an RGB image, meaning that each pixel is made up of a combination of red, green and blue to produce its colour. The white histogram represents the brightness of the image pixels rather than their colour. When I move the white level to meet the white histogram, you can see that I'm chopping off part of the red and green histograms. If you look at the histogram panel at the top of my screen, you can see that I'm now clipping those channels in the highlights. In the first lesson, I explained it was best to avoid clipping because you can lose detail in the image. With this image, the clipping is in the brightest areas of the sky and it doesn't look to be damaging the image at all. I will, though, reduce the white level slightly to make the sky look a bit better. If I turn the layer off and on, you can see the improvement. Now, if you're thinking the image looks a little too dark, you can adjust the gamma level to correct it. When I move the gamma slider to the right, it darkens the image, and if I move it to the left, we lighten it. All the time this is happening, the black and white points in the histogram are unchanged. It's the rest of the pixels in the histogram that we're changing. A value of 0.95 seems to produce a reasonable brightness. If I turn the layer off and on, you can see the adjustments improve the contrast and the colour but without making the image too dark. When I'm finished making the adjustments, I can close the dialog. As mentioned, layers are non-destructive, which means we can turn them off and even delete them to remove their effect. We can also double-click an adjustment layer to reopen its dialog. Notice this displays the same settings as when the dialog was closed. This allows us to refine the settings if we later think the effect is too strong. But we can also reduce the strength of the effect without changing the settings in the dialog. All we need to do is select the layer in the Layer Studio panel and reduce its opacity. You can think of the opacity of the layer as controlling its transparency, which in turn affects the strength of the effect. When the opacity of the layer is at 100%, the effect is at full strength. If we reduce the opacity, it lessens the layer's effect on the image. By the time the opacity is at 0%, it's the same as hiding the layer. Now let's add a second layer to this image, but this time we'll make it a vibrance adjustment. This allows us to increase or reduce the intensity of the colours in the image. The vibrancy dialog has a vibrancy slider and a saturation slider. The difference between the two is that the saturation slider affects all colours equally, where the vibrance slider is more limited. Most of the time you only need to adjust the vibrance slider, so let's increase the vibrancy in this image by moving the slider to the right. You can see this has a limited effect on the colours in the sky and on the rocks. To show you the difference, watch what happens when I use the saturation slider instead. The effect is much stronger and seen across all colours in the image. Now, a common mistake made by Affinity Photo beginners is to use this layer to convert coloured images to black and white. When I drag the saturation slider to the far left, it does remove all the colours from the image. Whilst this produces a black and white image, we don't have much control over the effect. That's why it's better to make black and white conversions using the black and white adjustment layer. Let's add a black and white adjustment layer by clicking the icon at the bottom of the layers panel. You can see in the black and white dialog that there are several coloured sliders. These relate to the colours in a colour wheel, being red, green and blue, as well as yellow, cyan and magenta. The default position of the sliders is at the centre at 100%. By moving the slider right or left, we can make the colours lighter or darker in the image. Watch what happens when I move the yellow slider left and right. You can see it changing the yellow areas of the image, making them darker or lighter. One way to use this dialog is to move each slider left and right to understand how it affects the image. You can then work your way through the sliders, deciding the settings for each. If you decide to start again, click the reset button to reset the sliders to their default position. But there's another way to use the dialog. When I move my cursor over the image, you can see that it has an arrow with a small horizontal line below it. I can use this to click a point in the image with my mouse to sample it. Then, whilst holding down my mouse button, I can drag left to make that area darker or right to make it brighter. As I do this, you can see the sliders in the dialog are responding. Also, like other layers, we can reduce the opacity of the layer to allow colour to begin to show in the image again. Let's group these layers together. We can do this by selecting them in the Layers Studio panel. I'll click on the top layer and then, holding down the Shift key, I'll click on the lowest layer I want to include. I can also pick individual layers by holding down my Command key or Control key on a PC and then clicking the layer. You can see I now have multiple layers selected, which are highlighted in blue. Then, when I click the Group layer icon, it groups the selected layers together. If I expand the group, you can see the individual layers again. As with the individual layers, I can turn off the group to hide all its layers with a single click. Now, there is a keyboard shortcut that I want you to learn and burn into your memory. It's Shift plus Option plus Command plus E. Or, if you're using a PC, that's Shift plus Control plus Alt plus E. When you press these keys together, you create a new pixel layer in the image, which consolidates all the other visible layers. In the Layers panel, you can see the new layer is a pixel layer and identical to the other visible layers. The more you use Affinity Photo, the more useful you'll find this keyboard shortcut. And please don't look for it in the menu because it isn't there. You can, though, replicate it using the Copy Merge feature in the Edit menu. After clicking Copy Merge, you can paste the clipboard to create a new layer in the image. Let's delete these layers now by selecting them and then clicking on the dustbin icon at the bottom of the Layers Studio panel. As we've been working through this lesson, you may have noticed several distracting cars in the image. If we compare this with the edited image, you can see that I've removed the cars in that one. I'll show you how to do this in the next lesson using Affinity Photo's clone tool and healing brush tool. If you can't see that lesson displayed now, it's because it's not yet published. Also, don't forget to subscribe so that you don't miss the next lesson in this course. It's going to be an extremely useful one.